So, thank you very much for attending this seminar and for inviting me to talk during these difficult times. So today we'll speak about forest, water, and climate, which is a very big topic. So we narrow down it a little bit. And as I'm now at in the Institute of Advanced Studies of Technical University of Munich, and our focus group is drought mitigation through ecosystem restoration, challenges and opportunities. And today I will tell you about what is being done now here and what are our aspirations and what, in the view of the results that we are obtaining, what are the pending questions in this area? And also, I will tell a little bit about implications and larger scale plans, but this is a time to meet. And I hope that we will have time for questions and some discussion. So, and now we turn to the rest of life's most important equation. And I think that most people who have gathered here appreciate it, that this is the one of the major things that pertains to life on Earth and on life on land. So precipitation, according to the mass balance, is equal to evapotranspiration and runoff. But evapotranspiration is difficult to measure, as we all know. So we need very complicated methods to estimate it. And we do know that forests determine evapotranspiration and so make a major impact to the water cycle. But what happens to precipitation and runoff when we change the forest cover or vegetation cover, and how do they change? And this is a very complex question. And many people worked on this topic, and you can see references to some more recent reviews. And how is this problem approached? We can assume that if precipitation is constant, then reducing evapotranspiration will give us more runoff. And this is the case, for example, of the Bavarian Forest National Park, where a lot of trees were killed by the bark beetle outbreaks during recent decades. And you can see here on the right the graphs that show the percentage of disturbance. And indeed, we can see here on the right graph in the lower corner that the runoff has increased despite the precipitation remains nearly constant. There is a reverse case. And again, if precipitation is constant, then increasing evapotranspiration is, we can do it when we do afforestation and plant trees like people are doing in China. Then we can risk to have a reduction in runoff. And this is what is indeed happening in some regions in China. And these are very precious data because there are large-scale efforts on increasing the vegetation cover. And we can see that, for example, here in the Upper Han River Basin, this increase in forest cover and in evapotranspiration, you can see the proportion of forest has grown, but the water yield and runoff has declined. On the other hand, again, looking at this fundamental equation and not knowing how to handle it, we can now assume that runoff is constant. And then reducing evapotranspiration will decrease precipitation. And indeed, this is also the case in southern Brazilian Amazon, where we can see that deforestation causes a scale-dependent decline in precipitation. So when you look at larger regions that are affected by deforestation, like the rich cell that 200 kilometers linear size, you can see a progressive decline in precipitation. So we need to assume some constancy of one or another flux in the water budget, but the overall picture looks very complicated and without apparent discernible patterns. Is there a general pattern? So actually possible clues come from atmospheric humidity, which is abbreviated here like CWV, and this is cold water vapor. And in 2010, but also before that, but this is a particularly detailed study coming from a very small island in the Pacific Ocean. Holloway Neelin showed that rainfall probability grows very rapidly with increasing column of water vapor. So when we have the amount of moisture in the column, like around 60 millimeters, the probability to have rain in the next hour is like 30%. And it grows exponentially. And in 2014, our team looked at this curve and mapped the Amazonian moisture content onto this curve. And we showed that indeed in forests, there is high, where the moisture content is high, they are located on the steep part of the curve, while unforested regions are in the steeper part of the curve. And we can see here that very small changes in the atmospheric moisture content can initiate large changes in precipitation. And so we proposed and hypothesized at the time that the forest actually can trigger or suppress or regulate rainfall by small changes in conditions that can be achieved by transpiration and other processes. And so this year there was a very interesting study by Mara Budena, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing correctly, but anyway, and colleagues who actually calculated this precipitation curve for the Amazon forest. What did they do? They took this area and calculated the amount of cone water vapor and the amount of hourly rain according to each moisture content. And so they plotted this curve, which they shared. This is, we plotted it in a different scale, semi-log scale. And you can see that it forms nearly a perfect exponential curve. So you can see that this is exponential scale, like from 10 to 100,000 millimeter per year. And this actually, this curve measured in the Amazon, depending on the cone water vapor, actually harbors all the diversity of wetness conditions on Earth, like from the projected Neom City in Saudi Arabia with its 25 millimeters per year. This is Bavarian Forest Park, Amazon, Congo Forest, this is Pechorel, which nature reserve in Russia. And the highest rainfall rate, again measured in the Amazon, it corresponds to Hurricane Eyeball. So this around five, this like more than 10 millimeters per hour or to about 100,000 millimeters per year. So, and their idea was that As precipitation depends exponentially on water vapor, on the amount of water vapor, but evapotranspiration contributes linearly to the column of water vapor. So a reduction of evapotranspiration due to deforestation will decrease the rainfall not proportionally, like we considered before, according to the recycling ratio, but much more than that, according to this curve. And this is very important. And here comes our own analysis, which is still a work in progress. So I'm just sharing between colleagues. So if we bring in the law of matter conservation, and we know that evapotranspiration contributes linearly to column water vapor, and we know the dependence of precipitation on column water vapor, we can actually integrate the equation for evapotranspiration and have an equation for the entire budget of the course. So we know P, we know evapotranspiration, and from the mass balance, we know also the runoff, the residual. And here comes a very, what looks to us a very interesting result, that we can see two ecosystem regimes. The drier one, when an increase in evapotranspiration reduces runoff and moisture convergence, also because in a because in a steady state, runoff is equal to moisture convergence. And there is then a higher values of atmospheric moisture. There is a regime when rising evapotranspiration increases runoff and moisture convergence. So two regimes. And here an example, if we turn again to China, we can see that while in a drier area, which I showed you, there was indeed a decline in runoff upon afforestation, but in a more wet region, also in China, actually afforestation did increase runoff and moisture conversion. And I just want to show you some example. What does this curve actually mean? So at very low humidity, at very low atmospheric moisture, we don't have any evaporation. This is, we can think of it as an unvegetated state. And so here a runoff comes this is video from Saudi Arabia, when you can have areas where rainfall only comes once in several hours, in several years, but then it is all flooded. And of course, there is no evaporation or evapotranspiration because it's too quick. And so all this water is lost to the ocean. And this is dry regime when the water is lost to so when the ecosystem is so weak that it loses all moisture, and that is why the first step in ecosystem recovery is to reduce runoff. Example of the second regime is provided, of course, by the great tropical forests, the Amazon and Congo forests. And here also there are several recent research papers which show that indeed evapotranspiration induces moisture convergence and facilitates the onset of the wet season in the Amazon forest. Also, the same preceding evapotranspiration that increases atmospheric moisture and hence induces rainfall was shown for northeast Indian monsoon. And very recently, there was a paper by Warden et al. About Congo. Congo is much less known, with much less certainty the water cycle is there, but still it is also clear from isotopic analysis of rainfall that evapotranspiration is tightly coupled to the wet season. And in the Amazon, this impact of evapotranspiration on the onset of wet season is pronounced than the famous dry season greening, which is and simplifying, we can say that when the forest decides that it is time to rain, he makes new green leaves, begins to transpire, fills the atmosphere with moisture, and this starts the wet season. And so we, in this second regime, moist regime, which we can call the biotic regime, because here both precipitation and moisture convergence are under strong biotic control. The evapotranspiration and evaporation plays a very big role under wet conditions. And we know indeed that forests can transpire under very wet conditions. This is example of a tropical forest in Papua New Guinea. But this is also the same picture, very similar. It is was taken in Russian Prisutsky Nature Reserve. And we can see that even though these are very, very different geographically and in terms of biodiversity, very different forests, but they work very when the conditions are allow, physical conditions allow that, they work very similarly. And finally, this is a very recent study, also tropical forest in Costa Rica, when they recorded just visible water vapor plumes, which showed that there is very considerable evaporation during rain, a phenomenon which was emphasized by Shigeki Murakami in his 2006 publication, and he also proposed an explanation for that related to the evaporation from splashing droplets. So this all shows that indeed the evaporation above the forest canopy is considerable and contributes to the precipitation and moisture convergence. So to summarize this part of my talk, we can see that the nonlinear increase in precipitation with atmospheric moisture constant testifies for increasing evapotranspiration being associated with increasing moisture convergence. But this is also consistent with data from isotopic analysis of tropical forest moisture and with the newly available data that testified about the significance of evaporation under very wet conditions. So this is what I wanted to tell you about the evidence about the role of moisture forests in driving the atmospheric moisture transport. So, and the problems that are outlined in this new picture with the two ecosystem regimes, which can be called abiotic and biotic, is manifold. One of them is how to perform ecosystem recovery and not get stuck in the drying zone, because this zone, we start from a certain geophysical precipitation on which the weak vegetation exerts practically no control. And the vegetation starts to lose this precipitation. And of course, the runoff is reduced. But if the vegetation becomes too much of it, so it could also deplete those stores of moisture that are already there, which is sometimes the case with China apple. So it is important to understand the peculiarities of this division of abiotic and biotic regimes for each particular regional ecosystem. Then, if we are talking about European forests, which we would like to drive to a more natural state, what is the forest state in which it contributes maximally to the stability of the cycle and how to reach it? And of course, each regional forest ecosystem, which has, will have its own peculiarities of this transition and how these two regimes look like. So, and here we come to the second part of my talk, which is about what questions we would like to further tackle. And this biotic pump and its impact of moisture transport has direct relevance to the very important problem which disrupts normal functioning of and human life on the continents, is the puzzle of heat waves and blocking anticyclones. What is briefly the problem? The problem is that if you read reviews of this topic, you will see that the research community does recognize that there is no theoretical framework to describe this phenomenon. And basically, it is clear why. If we think about atmospheric motion, motions as driven solely by temperature gradients, the heat waves and blocking anticyclones pose this question. If the air rises when and where it is warm, why during heat waves it descends? Why does it descend? So, and this is what prevents this lack of ideas on this, is what in our view prevents the progress in this area. And so I just briefly tell you that here the biotic pump does provide a clue which has to be investigated, and it consists in the following. What the biotic pump is about pressure gradients that are formed during condensation. So when moisture, water vapor condenses, the pressure falls, there are pressure gradients, and moist air moves towards the area of low pressure. But if we have a warm and moist area, then the air moving there from the cooler area, there will be evaporation into this warming area, and there can be cases when this temperature gradient is so large that the amount of evaporated moisture will negate the amount that will condense when the air will rise. And so in this case, the biotic pump cannot work and this circulation won't happen. And this is what can happen during a heat wave. Because here you can see these are the results from the heat wave in the United States in 2000 in the 2012, and so you can see here that there was initially during the beginning of this heat wave there was initially a lot of evapotranspiration, and this is like if there is an initial temperature anomaly and there is increased evaporation, so the air cannot, according to the biotic pump, but to no other concept, it cannot efficiently flow towards this area. So, and there are threshold temperature contrasts that block the ascending motion of moisture. So there are many cases when the conventional paradigm of warm air rising and the biotic pump, they do coincide, because when it is warm and moist, there is a lot of water vapor and a lot of energy available for the biotic pump to act. But in this particular case of strong temperature gradients, it doesn't work for the biotic pump, and the conventional paradigm doesn't explain it at all. But the biotic pump does explain, and we can quantify the magnitude of these gradients. And the bad news is that if you look at those temperature contrasts that are realized during heat waves and that are realized due to deforestation, the land ocean temperature contrasts are on the rising continent are pretty close to the threshold. So if we continue deforestation, and if these contrasts grow further with global warming, land ocean temperature contrast, we can see these very unfavorable fluctuations of the water cycle. And this brings us to the question of the climate benefits of intact forests, which are forests that are least disturbed by human influence. And we know, for example, from the study of Bacon and Spracklin from the Amazon, that those forests that were not disturbed by deforestation of fires, they practically didn't, showed very little warming of their surface compared to their counterparts, those areas where there was no disturbance. But what do we know about natural Eurasian forests in this context? What do we know about this huge boreal forest belt in Russia? We know very little, but it is very important for the climate of Western Europe. And so, yes, this is forest which we know very little about. And so here now we come to the implications. So what do we need our forests for? We were here in Bavaria on a great trip to Schliersee, on October, and we had a beautiful walk, and it was a beautiful weather, and we saw such information tables representing the trees. And so it was like the first thing that we were informed about: usage. So this tree is used for furniture. This tree, the willow, is used cricket bats. And this is our culture. So this is how we are used to think of the trees and the forest. And unfortunately, this translates into current attitudes about how forests are entering the climate debates, because here we only consider carbon storage and albedo. That's it. Already when we make first accounts of what is the impact of forests via the control of the cloud cover, we can see that these conventional approaches do not work. So we are seriously underappreciating the role of forests in climate, and this should be urgently changed. So the usage of natural forests is that they are really enabling life on land. And so what I think should be recognized in climate policies is that there are two different different universes, even two different dimensions to look at forests. And of course, we need tree and we need wood, but we need to separate the economic function and their climate function. And where the forests are still intact and still continuing to perform there this very complex climate stabilization function, we should leave them as they are. But on the contrary, where we need wood, we need produce it most efficiently such that the pressure on the natural forest is lessened. So we cannot exploit forests and expect that their climate function will be at its maximum. So I think that we need this dichotomy, recognize this dichotomy and implement it in our policies that involve forests. So conclusions are that we need to study natural forests as a phenomenon, recognize the naturalness of the forest is something which imparts to it very special properties, like the notion of health in humans. So it is something that should be studied with emphasis in climate research. Of course, we need to urgently preserve natural forests, and this is especially the case with boreal forests, which, as you saw on the IPCC graph, are considered basically useless for the climate. And so I don't know why our politicians are still allowed to talk about Russia increasing carbon intake with forests, while this graph shows that if we remove all our forests, it will be only better. So this is very dangerous and very primitive, in my opinion, and sorry, opposition. And so the forest what nexus, especially now in the context of more and more apparent role of clouds in climate uncertainty, forest water nexus is absolutely key for climate. And as we were discussing here, we are considering an international project sustaining the climate regulating function of forests in a water stressed world. So if you are interested, we are ready to communicate and discuss things. So I also thank you very much. And I thank Mara Bodin and her colleagues for providing the data, and Alexey Lenik, Phil Sherman for sharing their forest photos. And of course, my great thanks go to my host, Anya Ramik, who welcomed this controversial biotic pump topic here, and with whom I hope we will further advance in this important research. So thank you very much. Thank you.